What is happening, y'all? Cowboy here, and in this video, we're going to be taking a look at the summons, the incantations, and the sorceries that we have currently discovered in the Elden Ring Network Test. Now, when I say we, I'm referring to myself and a bunch of other Souls creators. I was in a Discord server with, like, Oro, and Peeve, and Prod, and Ruri, and Vadi, and Pineapple, and Lance, and just, you know, a bunch of people that play Souls. So this was all of us running around discovering stuff. As of now, we have found 11 incantations, 7 sorceries, and 5 summons. So let's jump on in and talk about summons first. Summons can be used anytime you're not doing multiplayer in Elden Ring, and it allows you to summon a spectral version of enemies that you've encountered in the world. They're super useful to distract bosses and just help you as you play in general, but you can't use them all the time. There's a little icon on the left side of my screen. Here, I'll put it over the blood puddle right now just to better delineate it. That little thing, it kind of looks like an archway or a gravestone. When you see that, it means you can use the summon. And they are just items. They're not class dependent. You do need FP to cast them. So ones like this that can't need 100, you're going to need to, you know, have a little bit of mind stat to pull that off. But otherwise, you just use them like an item. So first up, Noble Sorcerer. This one is very, very basic. You get this from like the starter merchant in the game. It's going to cast out like a soul dart. I mean, he's just like a decrepit old man. You know, he's not going to do much. But you can see, look at him. Look at him go. 6 damage. Wow. So yeah, this one, not all that good, and you need to pick and choose, because you only get one summon per rest. So if you have, you know, I can't do a new summon even after he dies until I have rested at a grace again. But even an unblocked attack will hit for like 11. For the most part, he's useless. I would not recommend him. Next up, we have Wandering Nobles. Now, you find this down in one of the dungeons, and this one's a little bit more useful, because you're getting 5 guys this time. So even if they're not all that good from a damage perspective, because they're like a bunch of frail old men, just the fact that it's 5 and a couple have torches, a couple have swords, they serve as a really good distraction. So this one can be really helpful on boss fights. They're not the strongest. You can see those health bars over on the left hand side of the screen, but it's still 5 different enemies. You know, it's your own personal little militia here. So, you know, if I wanted to let's say I wanted to cast, they got everything distracted, I can come in and just be like, wah! And you know, do all the damage. So that one gets pretty high grade from me. I think that, you know, the distraction factor makes them worthwhile. Moving on to one of my personal favorites, the Spirit Jellyfish. Now, this one is a really good one, in my opinion, for bosses. It's a little bit tankier. It has a bit of a unique hitbox where enemies can swing under it and whatnot. And it also shoots out a spell that can cause rot, which is like a damage over time effect. So if I'm sitting here fighting the guy, the jellyfish starts shooting his stuff, it'll apply this damage over time debuff. You can see him spitting it out on enemies there. This one doesn't do as well against groups. You know, it's very slow attacking, it floats around. But against bosses, it's very strong, because that attack it does, after 2 applications of that, there's going to be a damage over time debuff on bosses. So while not as good for stuff like this, I do feel that the jellyfish is really good in one-on-one situations, and you'll see some of that in other gameplay footage I upload. The Lone Wolf is actually pretty decent. This one you also get from the merchant. By the way, the jellyfish is just found out in the world. But the Lone Wolves, they do pretty well. It's 3 separate wolves. They're all just as voracious as all the wolves you have encountered up till now in Dark Souls. They're going to circle the target and jump around and hit it from behind, and they'll do pretty well. Also, the fact that there's 3 of them makes it a good distraction factor for the boss. They're not that tanky, and they will get blown away usually pretty easily, but this one also gets somewhat high marks just because they're aggressive. There's 3 of them, and on top of there being 3, they do a decent amount of damage. And the last one is also found in a dungeon, and this is the Northern Mercenary. These are the dudes you'll encounter in the network test that are riding around on the horses with the big swords, and they are just as brutal as a summon. This is definitely the strongest of the summons. They will get in the fray. They're very aggressive. They are not afraid to, you know, they will pop their rage thing and just sit there and beat the shit out of enemies. So if you want one that feels like you actually have a summon with you, he is probably going to be your best bet. He's going to fail against groups, because obviously it's just one dude fighting an entire army. But that aside, he can do really good damage, as you saw from a couple swings before he got overwhelmed. So either way, that is going to wrap things up for the summons. Let's jump on into incantations. Now, when I say incantations, I'm referring to any spells that are going to level with faith. In Elden Ring, all spells have been broken into 2 categories. Either they are incantations, or they are Sorceries. So looking down here, we've got an explanation. You can see intelligence boosts magic power of intelligence scaling sorceries and improves magic resistance. Faith boosts incantations that scale with faith and allows you to perform sacred incantations. Arcane is also going to be needed for certain sorceries and incantations, but everything is still grouped into one of two categories. Now, these categories are pretty broad. Sorceries are going to have sorceries, dark sorceries, blood magic. Incantations are going to have your traditional miracles, more unique stuff like dragon powers, as well as pyromancies. So either way, let's jump on in. The first three that we are going to be talking about are heal, urgent heal, and cure poison. Cure poison, really straightforward. It literally just cures poison. Not much else to say right there. Heal and urgent heal are different levels of healing. Let's take a couple hits here so that you can really see urgent heal and heal in action. If I just let this guy... Any of you, somebody hit me, please. So, heal is really strong. It goes off pretty fast. You can see I don't have a ton of room between me and these guys. And you can see heal is going to be a full heal for a relatively low FP cost at that. Too many to risk getting it again. Urgent heal will also throw out. And one of the big differences is, as you saw right there, it's going to be a little bit faster. And we're also still walking while we're using it, but it's not going to heal as much. So, really depends what you need, whether you're looking to get kind of a stationary, big old heal there. Also, this one will heal you and allies. This one will just heal you. Moving on from there, let's go to some of the other miracles in the game. Well, they're incantations now, but let's be honest. These are miracles. I know a miracle when I see one. First up is rejection. This is just force. Quite literally, you know, just knocks people on their ass. You can also shield break with it now. I think you could do that before, but anyway, we have four still. We have a Litany of Proper Death, which is really, really cool. Now, this move isn't going to look like much here. In fact, you'll probably see it and be like, what did he even do? But it's a very, very wide area, as you saw there. I'll get up on the cliff and do it again. But this creates like almost a giant, I can't tell if it's a circle or a cone, but very, very large area. And as you can see, it's only doing like a little bit of damage to guys like this, but against undead enemies, it's like an instant kill. It's like 200-300 damage. And one of the things that's cool is enemies in this game that are undead are more like Dragon's Dogma-esque, or I guess original Dark Souls had it too, where like you need to kill them with a weapon that is blessed, or you need to use this, otherwise they'll just keep resurrecting over and over again. So really nice utility there. Next we have Beast Claw, which is hands down just the swankiest new move. I love this thing. This is the starter offensive faith miracle. Look at it. It just fucking shreds. It has like no cost. It's super strong. Honestly, I would be very surprised if this doesn't end up getting nerfed before launch, because I have just absolutely dominated every bit of content in the game using that. Now, another thing that's new in Elden Ring, which I like a lot, are we can charge spells. So if I start from right at this body, let's see, it's going about to the grass right there. Now, if I charge it, you can see it's going deep into the grass. So the charge also goes wider, it's going to go farther, and it's going to deal more damage, which is really cool. Now, not every spell can be charged, but there are quite a few of them that can be. And that is a really significant change for casters, in my opinion. Moving on from those three, let's talk about the pyromancies. Next up we have O Flame, Feast Upon Slay Flame, and then the Flame of Frenzy. O Flame is combustion. That's it. Just, you know, run up. Boom, fire. Boom, fire. Comes out fast still. Still decent as like a catch in PvP. You know, if you can get people unaware, you can do a lot of damage with it. Then we have Feast Upon Flame, which is basically like your fireball. And we can, this is another chargeable, so a regular one, you throw it. Still decent damage. Gather up. and die. We can also charge it up, as I mentioned. Here we get a little bit of splash on it. And then we have the Flame of Frenzy, which is another charge one, and this one's kind of hard to connect with. If you use it too much, it'll also inflict madness on you. Full charge. Oh, come on, you. This one's a little bit tricky to use, only because it's going all over the place, but as you can see, it does pretty decent AoE potential there, hitting a bunch of different enemies. It's just not very targeted, which makes it less than ideal in my opinion, but still a really cool flame to use, and also one that I think will end up catching a lot of players off guard, just because of how wild it is in its attack approach. Moving on from there, we have... I believe one more, and then just dragon incantations. There might be one more miracle. Let's see. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 10, 11. Okay, yeah, the last two are the dragon incantations. And those are dragon fire and then Grail's roar. Now, both of these are some thick boy incantations. These are going to use up a ton of your FP. It's gonna just gobble your whole bar up, but they are devastating spells. Dragonfire, you actually start with one of the classes, the champion, but I want this guy to pull everybody in. Let me get rid of you. You're annoying. Everybody else, come and gather. And yeah, I mean, basically, as long as you have FP, you can just hold it and keep casting. It'll do a lot of damage. It'll nuke bosses, but man, that thing gobbles up FP. It just guzzles through it. The other one, which is arguably even more impressive and the strongest spell, I would say, that I have discovered thus far in Elden Ring, and this is Grail's Roar. Now, this is a massive, massive AoE roar. And honestly, the enemies here, they're not even going to do it justice, but, I kind of wanted to keep this in the class video relatively spoiler-free, so I'm just kind of sticking to this area, showing basic enemies, but... massive AoE. It'll just basically kill anything that gets caught in it. But on other enemies, I've seen this do upwards of 900 damage. Like the big giants that roam the world and whatnot that we've seen in the trailers, I've hit them with it. And the one of them I killed in two uses of it. It'll also like instantly shield break, as you saw right there. So very, very, very powerful incantation. But either way, that is going to wrap things up for incantations. Let's take a look at some sorceries. So for our sorceries, we have 7 spells to look at, similar to how pyromancies and miracles are all under incantations. Now we have our regular sorceries, we have dark sorceries, and then we have blood magic as well. And these have all been grouped under sorceries now. So the first 3 that we have are Glintstone Pebble, Glintstone Stars, and Glintstone Arc. All 3 of these are very basic, 7, 14, and 10, so low FP costs. These should be you think of these as like almost like your soul arrows. So all very simple. Glintstone Pebble, damage isn't too bad. You can kill enemy, 3 hits if they block, usually 1 hit or 2 hits if they are unaware. But it's very simple, Low cast cost, nothing too crazy, has pretty respectable distance, cast it out fast. Then we have Glintstone Stars. These are similar, but they'll cost more, and they'll do 3 that'll seep on into the enemy. Little bit more damage, but damage to FP, not necessarily worth it. Now, the last one I'm actually going to gather up everything for, but that is the Glintstone Arc. Now, Glintstone Arc's pretty cool. I would almost describe it as, like, this class's version of Beast Claw. For those of you that are playing the network test, you actually need to find this one. Which, just to show, these are all over the place, but Glintstone Arc is, like, right around here. There's, like, some crabs that have it. And then a lot of the sorceries you get from here in a cellar on the map. The miracles, on the other hand, those are all over the place. So that could be a whole video in and of itself. But yeah, Glintstone Arc's pretty cool. It'll toss out a arc that'll go through, hit multiple enemies. So if I use this guy to summon up all the baddies, Call to arms? Let's see, this is my AoE action. Smacking them now, killing everything. So yeah, pretty cool. You know, sorcery usually doesn't have wide AoE options like that, so really like that spell. Thought that was pretty neat. Moving on from there, though, let's talk about some others. So next, we are going to talk about Carrion Piercer, Magic Bubble, and then Meteorite. Now, Carrion Piercer is a chargeable spell. This is kind of like a Soul Greatsword. You can either do it really fast, and it'll just throw out like that, thrust people. Or you can charge it. The charge will take a bit longer. We'll let this guy do his bugle, and then we'll charge. You can see there's a bit of knockdown when you get the charge off, but otherwise it's straightforward. Magic Bubble's kind of interesting. I'm not sure how potent this is. If you catch something blank range with it, it kind of works, but it's a really weird spell, you know, because we're just casting little bubbles that float at the enemy. Get some distance so you can actually see the bubbles. Kill this one guy. But yeah, the bubbles will go on out and eventually they'll pop. Either when enemies walk into them or they'll just explode on their own. Not the best, but it is what it is. The last one in this set is going to be Meteorite, which looks really cool, but really isn't that good. So Meteorite, when you single cast, or call down three Meteorites. Hey, actually got one guy, cool. What's cool about Meteorite is you can hold it, and as long as you have FP, this thing will keep on casting, so you can summon down a bunch of Meteorites. And, like, visually, that's badass, you know? You're just like, death to all! You're just meteor raining out of the sky. But at the same time, I mean, it doesn't really hit stuff that well, so it's kind of like, is this actually good? I don't know. And the last one for our showcase that I've found so far is Briars of Sin. Briars of Sin is like a blood magic. What it's going to do is create thorns around your character. It deals damage to your health, causes you to take laceration as well, but it can hurt enemies a decent amount. Kind of risky to use, obviously, because you're hurting yourself in the process of it. It can also be charged up, which I'll need to heal to show off, but that's the charged version, and that's the regular version. So that is going to wrap things up. There may be even more spells in the network test, but this is after, like, probably 100 hours between all of us that have been playing this early, searching around and finding the map. Now, if you're a melee person, the one thing I want to say is we do have some cool stuff for melee in the Ashes of War. I'm going to show that very, very briefly, but I could do an entire video on Ashes of War, and I probably won't, only because they apply to all kinds of different weapons, and, you know, there's like an endless variety here. But the way Ashes of War work is we can essentially change the custom attack on our weapon. So right now this is Piercing Fang, and this is like your weapon art from Dark Souls 3, so this will also cost FP. But if you don't like that, I could go to Ashes of War, and let's change this to Determination. And I can see, you know, going here, which will do Determination, a truly knightly skill. Hold your armament to the face and pledge to resolve powering up your next attack. So if I do that, it's going to power that up, and then I can get more damage on my attack. But you can change that. I mean, there's a ton of them. On one of the melee classes, I have like 6 or 7 different Ashes of War to choose from for my Bastard Sword. So there is a lot of variety in this game for the melee players as well. But either way, that is going to wrap things up. Let me know what you guys think. Based on what I've seen so far, I'm really leaning towards being a Faith guy. Faith just, it's looking really good. So anyway, y'all stay tuned, and I'll have more coming your way soon.